Okay, he is the Pulitzer Prize-winning columnist for the New York Times and author of the number one New York Times bestseller, Thank You for Being Late. Thomas Friedman is with us, I'm assuming, from New York. And
no, Bethesda, Maryland.
Oh, okay. So your columns have been fantastic in these horrible times. Horrible times, great columns. And, of course, when I read them, I can't help but thinking of your seminal book, The World is Flat, and how you are the guy who really identified that issue, that we're all so interconnected. And originally that was more about economics and technology, but now we see it's really about disease too, right?
Yeah, I mean, basically, Bill, I've been looking back at the last 20 years, what I realized, I've actually been covering one pandemic after another, but of a different kind. First, I covered a geopolitical pandemic called 9/11. Then I covered a financial pandemic called 2008. Now I'm covering a biological pandemic called COVID-19. And I'm probably about to cover a atmospheric pandemic called climate change. And the reason these are happening more often is because, one, the world is getting more greased, more tightly wound together through globalization, technology, air travel. Who knew that there were 50 flights from Wuhan direct to America, between December and March?
Yeah.
And at the same time, Bill, we're taking a lot of the buffers out of things that really created redundancy, stabilized systems, whether it was ultra-greased supply chains or diversity. And then we're pushing things to the extreme. Jihadi radicals pushed them to the extreme around 9/11. Bankers pushed them to extreme around 2008. We pushed ecosystems to the extreme, ended up with bats in domestic food markets. We're pushing the climate to the extreme. And you put all these together, and the world isn't just flat now, it's increasingly frail by being so tightly together and at the same time pushing a lot of things to their limits and beyond.
So I'm almost afraid to ask you about what your level of optimism is given that situation. I quoted you a couple of weeks ago on our show in your column when you said that America has been as dumb as we want to be. That really has been our policy, and it's true, not just the politicians, but all of us for a very long time, and now it's coming home to roost. And when I read the paper every day, all I see is, God, could we have fucked this up worse? We tried to save the hospitals, so now we're bankrupting them. Testing, other countries seem to be able to get that. The one lab Trump has been touting, 48% of the time it works. You could flip a coin and do it just as well. You know, if you had a pregnancy test that half the time was, well, I guess that's wrong, I am pregnant, I don't think we'd be using that. I mean, we are just so bad. And so how do you even begin to reverse this level of dysfunction?
Well, it seems to me a couple things are going on, Bill, that were, one, reaping what was sowed, not on your show, but on another network. We've lost our cognitive immunity. That's a term my friend Marina Gorbis from the Institute of Future coined. We've lost our ability to sort out fact from fiction and science from science fiction. Because, one, we have a network that's been in the business of making people angry and stupid. And at the same time, we have social networks, whether it's Facebook or Twitter or others, that are, look, these social networks are like open sewers. They're full of untreated, unfiltered information. They have diamonds and rubies and gold and gems, and they have toxic waste, rusty cans and broken glass. And if you don't have a population that has the filters to sort out one from the other, you get to where we are today. Then overlay on that, Bill, we're kind of caught between what I call breaking news and President Breaking Bad. You know, on the one hand, we're just assaulted with breaking news. 24 kids in New York City have acquired an inflammatory disease post-COVID-19. But it's not put in any context. So you don't know, is that like one out of, 100,000? Is it one out of 1,000? But when you're constantly pounded with these breaking news stories, it's very hard to find your balance. And at the same time, then you have a president out there who basically is touting, ultraviolet light colonoscopies and Lysol enemas or hydrochloroquine that has been rejected by his own FDA. And between the two, Bill, it's become very hard, I think, for the average citizen to weigh the risks. When do I go out? When do I not go out? Do I send my kids back to school? Do I not? Because no one is shaping the conversation at the top the way a real president would be doing in such a crisis. And other leaders around the world have been.